بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I welcome you to another episode of our series, As-Safaratul Kiram, where we strive to be in the company of the holy and blessed angels by perfecting the art of reciting the Quran, the art of Tajweed. As always, we always like to start off our show with an interesting fact about the Quran. And in today's show, I'd like to mention something called Asbab al-Nuzul. This is a very important branch of understanding the Qur'an. In fact, it is no exaggeration to state that a person who does not understand and know Asbab al-Nuzul cannot understand and interpret the Qur'an. What exactly is Asbab al-Nuzul? Well, the Qur'an was revealed to cater to specific situations that occurred in the Muslim Ummah in the time of the Prophet ﷺ. Any particular incident or act or question that was the cause of a revelation of a verse is called a sabab al-nuzul, and the plural of that is asbab al-nuzul. So any particular incident or occurrence or question or act which was the direct cause of the Quran being revealed, we refer to this as the cause of revelation, the sabab al-nuzul. Now the sabab al-nuzul is an integral part of understanding the verse in question. This is because many times you will not be able to understand what the verse is referring to unless and until you understand the sabab al-nuzul. For example, Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَلِلَّهِ الْمَشْرِقُ وَالْمَغْرِبُ فَأَيْنَمَا تُوَلُّوا فَثَمَّ وَجْهُ اللَّهِ. And to Allah belongs the East and the West. So wherever you turn, you will face the direction of Allah. You will face the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some people might understand this verse to imply that you can face any direction in the prayer. You don't have to face the Kaaba. Because wherever you face, Allah Azza wa Jal will be there and your reward will be accepted. However, when you understand the reason that this verse was revealed, this interpretation or misinterpretation will be destroyed. And that is that a number of companions were in the middle of the desert and they wished to pray, but they did not know the direction of the Qibla. So they tried their best to estimate where Mecca was, and then they all prayed in whatever direction they thought was the direction of Mecca, but they were mistaken in that direction. So when they came back to the Prophet ﷺ and they told him about this, Allah revealed this verse. That okay, you tried your best, you weren't able to find the direction of the Kaaba, but in the end of the day, it doesn't really matter because you tried and you were not able to do so, so Allah will not call you to task for something which is beyond your control. Therefore, wherever you turn, your reward and your prayer will be accepted. Likewise, in another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that there is no لَيْسَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ جُنَاحٌ فِيمَا طَعِمُوا. There is no sin upon the believers who believe and do good regarding whatever they eat. There is no sin on them as long as they believe and do good deeds and believe and have taqwa of Allah, so on and so forth. There is no sin. Now someone might come and say, okay, well then, how come pork is prohibited? Allah is clearly saying there is no sin. Likewise, why can't I drink and why can't I do this and that? Allah is saying there is no sin on what I eat. But when you study the reason why the verse was revealed, this misinterpretation will disappear. And that is that, early on in Islam, there were no restrictions, dietary restrictions. The companions would drink alcohol because it was permissible at that time. Then they passed away, some of them, before the ruling of alcohol was revealed. So the companions question one another, well now alcohol is haram, what will be the result, what will be the, problems or the punishment that will happen to our friends who died before the revelation of this verse. So Allah revealed that there is no sin because at that time it was not prohibited. They did believe and they did good and they followed the Quran up to what it was revealed, so there is no sin upon them. Therefore, when you understand the cause of revelation, you will be able to understand the proper interpretation of the verse. This is an integral part of the science of tafsir, of interpretation. He who does not know this science cannot interpret the Qur'an. Let us now move back to our topic of tajweed. And we finished mudud. Now we move on to a very advanced topic, if you like. And this is a topic of the special types of idgham. We have idgham, which is a special type, it's a more advanced type, and we're going to dedicate two episodes to this. So today we'll discuss the first of the special types of idgham. What was idgham? Who remembers? The merging, where two letters merge together. This is the meaning of idgham. There are special types of idgham, The good news is we have really covered most of the rules of Tajweed. What is remaining are the advanced or slightly advanced rules, and they are not very common in the Quran. So if you understand it, alhamdulillah. If not, stick with what you know and slowly and surely build on these future lessons bit by bit. Today we'll discuss a number of types of idgham. Number one is two same letters. What I mean by that is any time a silent letter is followed by the same letter, idgham occurs. Very simple rule. Anytime you have a silent letter which is then followed by the same letter, you will have idgham. If that letter happens to be a noon or a meem, then you will also do a ghunna. So the general rule is anytime you have two noons and two memes, a noon shadda or a meem shadda, you will have ghunna over there. Let's give some examples. Here, قُلْ لَكُمْ قُلْ لَكُمْ. There is a silent lam followed by a lam with a fatha on it. Therefore, there will be a full idgham here. And you will say قُلْ لَكُمْ قُلْ لَكُمْ. Likewise over here, مِنْ نِعْمَة. You have a silent noon followed by a noon with a kasr on it. مِنْ نِعْمَة مِنْ نِعْمَة. You have a silent noon, and I did a ghunna as well because there was an idgham. So you have. Also, we've done this rule in Tajweed as well, by the way, in the rules of the Noon Sakinah. So this is just a broader category. The rules of Noon Sakinah was a more specific thing. Now we're looking at it from a broader perspective. Likewise, قَدْ دَخَلُوا قَدْ دَخَلُوا. Now here, you really see the fruit of idgham. If there were no idgham, how would you pronounce this? قَدْ دَخَلُوا. You would do a what? قَلْقَلَ on the dal. But because there's an idgham, what happens? You merge it so the qalqala is dropped. قَدْ دَخَلُوا. Okay, because you have idgham. This is where you really clearly see what it means to do an idgham. Because had there been no idgham, like in the قُلْ لَكُمْ, you might not really see it that clearly because it sounds the same. Okay, but over here you clearly see what happens. When you do an idgham, the qalqala has to drop. قَدْ دَخَلُوا. Another example or some more examples. Once again, the ba, which is a letter of qalqala, followed by another ba, the first one is silent. Had I not done a qalqala, I would say, اضرب بعصاك الحجر. But because there is a idgham, okay, because there is an idgham, I will say, اضرب بعصاك الحجر. Likewise over here, فلا يسرف في القتل. You have two fa's. The first fa is silent, the second fa has a kasra, so you will have an idgham. فَلَا يُسْرِفْ فِي الْقَاتِلِ. You will merge the two fa's together. Another example, يُدْرِكُمُ الْمَوْتِ. You have a first kaf which is silent, followed by a kaf which has a dhamma, so the two kafs will merge. يُدْرِكُمُ الْمَوْتِ. And over here, another example with ba, اِذْهَبْ بِكِتَابِ. You have a first ba which is silent, and the second ba which has a kasra on it, so you will merge the two and the qalqala will drop. اذهب بكتابي. One last example with the meme. You have am ماذا. Okay, what will happen now? The special thing is ghunna. We have here, if the two letters are noons or memes, there will be a ghunna. Am ماذا. There will be a ghunna on the meme. So the first type of the special idgham is the two same letters. Very simple, very easy. There should be no confusion here. Anytime there is a silent letter followed by the exact same letter with a haraka on it, you will do an idgham. And in fact, in the Quran that is printed in our times, we actually have a shadda where you have the fatha, where you have a shadda. So you already told. It is as if you are told that there will be an idgham here, so don't worry about it. But this is the actual rule. Anytime the two letters occur that are same, you will do an idgham. Okay, what if the two letters are not the same? Well, we get to point two now. Point two is that when you have two letters with close makharij, okay? So what is a makharij? Who remembers? Going back to one of the first lessons. The area where the voice or the sound or the letter is formed. If you have two letters with the same or the close makhraj, then once again there will be idgham. And these are two cases that occur between the lam and the ra. The lam and the ra, remember, they are very close to one another, the makhraj. Okay? We have قُلْ رَبِّي. What happens? You say قُرْ رَبِّي. The lam is completely dropped because you merge the ra with the qaf. قُرْ رَبِّي قُرْ رَبِّي. Likewise, بَلْ رَفَعَ, you have بَلْ رَفَعَ بَلْ رَفَعَهُ, like this, you drop the lam completely. Okay? And the second case where this occurs is between the qaf and the kaf. Okay, the qaf and the kaf as well. When they are together, you will drop the first one and merge to the second. Alam nakhluqkum. There's a qaf followed by a kaf. So what do?
Merge them.
You merge the lam with the kaf and you say, Alam nakhluqkum. Nakhluqkum. You immediately move on to the kaf and you drop the qaf. So these, you just have to memorize these, the lam and the ra and the qaf and the kaf, because obviously many of our viewers will not really be able to remember the makharij that well. So just memorize them, that whenever there's a lam followed by a ra, you will merge it. Likewise, whenever there's a qaf followed by a kaf, you will merge this as well. Okay, today I will recite Surah Nuh as practice, and follow along, we'll quiz you with the rules of tajweed that we have taken. Surah Nuh is Surah number 71 of the Quran.
A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Inna arsalna Nuhan ila qawmihi أن أنذر قومك من قبل أن يأتيهم عذاب أليم.
Okay, we have a lot of rules here we have to go over. Firstly, the noon with a shadd on it. What do we do here? We do a ghunna here. Inna. What type of mad is in the alif? Inna.
Separated mad.
It's a separated mad, so we have an option of 2, 4, or 5.
Oh, yes.
أرسلنا. What do we do with the ra?
Heavy ra,
because it's silent with a fatha before it. Nuhan ila. What is the ruling here?
Izhar,
clarity, because the tanween is followed by a hamza. Qawmihi. What type of mad is here?
Sila.
It's a mad sila, and we're allowed to do it 2, 4, or 5, because the ha is followed by a hamza. An anzir. What do we do with zir?
Two rules.
First,
the two rules. The first is izhar, and the second is ikhfa. And then the ra with the zir is light a lot, because there's a kasra before it. Qawmaka min qabli. Ikhfa. And qabli, what type of qalqala? The lowest type of qalqala. An ya'tiyahum.
That's
idgham with ghunna. Ya'tiyahum azab. What happened with the meem?
Idghar
shafawi, or the meem is pronounced clearly. Azabun alim. Idghar as well.
Qala ya qawmi inni lakum nazirun mubinun an i'budullaha wattaquhu wa ati'un. يغفر لكم من ذنوبكم ويؤخركم إلى أجل مسمى إن أجل الله إذا جاء لا يؤخر لو كنتم تعلمون.
Once again, we have the entire verses full of rules. We don't have time to do all of them, but يغفر لكم, we have the ra will be
light.
لكم من ذنوبكم, this will go over here where we have merged two similar letters, right? إدغام المثلين, and it also we've done this when we're talking about the ميم as well. إدغام شفوي, إدغام مثلين. من ذنوبكم is إخفاء. ويؤخركم, the ra will be
light.
إلى أجل مسمى, we have two غنّز. Because of the first one, ajalin will be idgham with ghunna. Musamma, we have mim mushaddad.
Yes.
Inna, once again, ghunna, ajal Allah idha ja'a. What type of mad is this?
Connected
mad. So I have to go far. Yu'akharu law kuntum ta'lamun. And inshallah, we'll continue the special types of idgham in our next episode. Until then, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.